Happy Canada Day. I'm Steve Cook, site manager of Uncle Tom's Cabin Historic Site in beautiful Dresden, Ontario, Canada. And I'm coming to you from the home of Josiah Henson. And our museum here is owned and operated by the Ontario Heritage Trust, which is a provincial agency responsible for conserving, protecting, interpreting, and sharing Ontario's heritage. And you can explore the work that we do by visiting our website at www.heritagetrust.on.ca. And the link is below in the description for this video. Now this summer, we're going to be developing and posting virtual programming, interviews, performances, live tours of the museum here. So keep checking our website and we'll be posting regular updates and our schedule of content there. So, but kicking off our summer programming today for Canada Day, we are specifically focusing on the Black contribution in the early development of this great nation of Canada, as seen through the eyes of Josiah Henson. He was a man born into slavery in Maryland, and he escaped to Canada via the Underground Railroad and eventually settled right here in Dresden. Now, of course, he wasn't the first Black man to arrive in Canada. That was Matthew DaCosta, who came from Africa in 1608, and he was a remarkable man. He spoke over 5 different languages. And since that time, African Canadians have played an indelible, they've made an indelible impact on the political, social, cultural impact here in the landscape of Canada. But of course, those contributions did not come without struggle. And as Henson wrote in his autobiography, which I have here published in 1849, he says, though Canada was the land of freedom to the fugitive slaves, yet they met with so much prejudice at first on account of their color that it was with difficulty they could procure the common comforts of life. Now, one man who has become intimately acquainted with the life of Josiah Henson over the past couple of years is Mr. Jared Brock. He's a film producer and the director of Josiah, a documentary about Henson's remarkable life. He's the author of 2 previous books, the most recent being this one here, The Road to Dawn, Josiah Henson and the Story That Sparked the Civil War. And I am happy to have Jared Brock joining me today. Hello, Jared. Happy Canada Day.
Hi, Steve. Happy Canada Day. Thank you.
How are you doing?
I'm great. And it's always good to see your face. I spent a lot of time with your face when we were editing you into the film. And it's we've hung out many times in Dresden, and it's good to be with you from across the pond today.
So you're over in jolly old England then?
Yeah, I'm in Wales, but close. Yeah, we're right near the Irish Sea.
Okay, very nice. Now, you weren't born there. Can you give us a little bit of background for those who aren't familiar with your story? Where are you born?
So I grew up in Guelph, Ontario. Went to a private school and took a lot of history classes, but I never learned about Josiah Henson in school at all. And it wasn't until much later that I learned anything about what we're going to talk about today. But yeah, I'm an Ontario boy born and raised.
So not a lot of exposure to Black history in your early life.
No, like, I mean, Harriet Tubman and Frederick Douglass are the mainstays. You take your Underground Railroad unit, but that's it. I think Henson made just as big of an impact as either of those two, certainly worthy of being in that echelon of historical figures that we celebrate, not just in Canada, but in the States and in the UK. Like, he's very much global history. Like, let's not relegate him to 1 month a year.
Mm-hmm. So take us on a journey of your discovery about Josiah Henson. How did you initially hear about him?
So it's thanks to my wife, Michelle. We were in a bookstore in Florida in 2014, and she'd been wanting to read Uncle Tom's Cabin for a long time. You know, this book that Abraham Lincoln said started the Civil War, right? Mm-hmm. And I saw it on the shelf and bought it for Michelle. And she read it that year and was really moved by it. And I'm a naturally inquisitive guy. I've written several books and made 3 documentaries before this. And so I did a little bit more research on Uncle Tom's Cabin. And somewhere in my internet searchings, I discovered that the character of Uncle Tom was inspired by this real man named Josiah Henson. And that really surprised me. I'd never heard about him before. And then I learned about Uncle Tom's Cabin Historic Site, the site that you manage, the museum. And so Michelle and I came the next summer and we visited it and we read that memoir that you held up at the beginning. And we were so moved by it. This man who won a medal at the first World's Fair, was entertained at Windsor Castle in the White House, rescued 118 people, including his own brother, you know, part of starting the Dawn Settlement, all this stuff. I was so moved by it. I said, I have to help make this man famous. So I ended up retracing his journey from slavery to freedom over 3,000 miles. We got to visit all the known plantations associated with his life, including two that were in private hands and one that was still owned by his slave owner's descendants, which was just a crazy thought how close history is. And that ended up leading into a couple of years of research. I wrote a biography and made a documentary. Now we're working on a miniseries. And yeah, so Josiah has been a big part of my life for the past, I guess, 5.5 years now. And he's got amazing lessons to teach us that are so applicable to today, like never before. And I'm really excited. I think Henson's best days are ahead. His family feels the same way. So I'm glad to be talking about him today.
Well, that's a good lead. And you talked about the lessons from his life. And the next question I wanted to ask you was about the revised edition, the second edition of his life story, Truth Stranger Than Fiction, that was published in 1858. And that was when his editor engaged Harriet Beecher Stowe, the author of Uncle Tom's Cabin, to write a letter of introduction. And in it, she states that among all the singular and interesting records to which the institution of American slavery has given rise, we know of none more striking, more characteristic and instructive than that of Josiah Henson. So I was curious, now that you studied his whole life through and through, what are some of the moments in his life that you, a viewer of your documentary, might find instructive?
There's so much. Henson is this brilliant man who has a way with words. He is good with money. He's very convincing, and with whites and blacks alike. You know, he rubs shoulders with the elites in Washington, D.C. when he is his master's market man in the city, in the nation's capital. He said that if he hadn't been born into slavery, he would have become a lawyer. He was very eloquent and very forceful. And, you know, it gets him audiences with the Archbishop of Canterbury, and he gets a job offer from Earl Grey. And, you know, he's very influential. But, you know, I think of how much ambition I have, how much talent I think I have, how many hopes and dreams I have for the future. And I'm nothing compared to Josiah Henson. Imagine being his caliber of person and being under the boot of slavery for 41 years. You know, as I walked the grounds in Kentucky where he was enslaved, and went to the pond where he would have fished, and went to the river where his cabin would have been, where he was, you know, 500 meters from freedom and on the Indiana side, just yearning and wanting that for so many years. He's got a wife and four sons, wanting them to be free. The heartache is so immense. And yet he never decides to pick up a gun. He never decides to pick up a sword. He's nonviolent. He's a resistor, obviously, but he's nonviolent. And, but he's working for freedom. He's sneaky. He's devious. He does what he has to do to survive, to escape, to thrive. But he does it in such a creative and brilliant way that I would hope that if I was in his situation, I would do the same thing. He doesn't give up, but he doesn't kill. He finds a way through. I can't imagine being in his position. I think that's just one thing, especially this year, as we've been watching what's going on in the States in the last few months, just like letting that empathy kind of wash over me again of like how horrific life was for him. You know, he couldn't raise his hands above his head because he had his shoulders shattered with fence posts. This is a man who, his story is incredible. And like Harriet Beecher Stowe said, there's nothing like it. Like, we don't have any recorded story that's as crazy and wide ranging as Henson's story. But that's probably one of the big things. I'm sure we can talk about the stewardship of freedom at some point, but yeah, just his ability to endure is something that I think we could all really take away in this moment.
And it's such an impactful life that he led, and it's so broad that it had to have been challenging trying to capture it on film in 45 to 60 minutes. But then you had the opportunity of capturing it on paper in your book as well. The challenges between the two, how did you manage that?
Yeah, film is very expensive. Obviously, we had to finish the documentary where he steps foot into Canada. He obviously has a massive second act where he builds a desegregated school 100 years before the end of Jim Crow, where he is part of a Freeman settlement and a brickworks and a sawmill and fundraising in Europe and a 90-city speaking tour in England and Scotland. And, you know, he has a huge second act, but we just didn't have the budget or the time or the bandwidth to do the second half of his life. So yeah, we really had to pick and choose with the documentary, unfortunately. The book, I tried to cover as best I could. I'm not a historian by background. This was my first shot at a biography. And it was basically a matter of cobbling together the hundreds and hundreds of sources and things written about all over the place, letters and newspaper articles and all, you know, in multiple countries, bringing that all together as best I could into a biography. But I'm really hoping that we can tell the whole story on film in some sort of a mini series. So that's the big thing I'm working on now. So we'll see what happens, but I keep, writing, telling people a story. I just published an article last week in The Guardian. It's been seen by like 50,000 people, like just doing what I can to get the story out there. And I know the 100 strong Henson family is always telling people about the story as well. So it's only a matter of time before Henson's story gets out there in a big way. Like, you know, hundreds of thousands of people Google Frederick Douglass every month, but only a couple thousand Google Josiah Henson. So there's a lot of opportunity for him to grow into the national spotlight that he probably deserves.
Now, in your book, The Road to Dawn, available at your local gift shop, everybody, you wrote, "I didn't realize how poorly my own country treated African Americans, or how widely the remnants of racism and slavery lay scattered." So fast forward to today, and we have this incredible Black Lives Matter movement that's spread globally. Do you think it will lead to real change this time? Because we've seen movements in the past that have tackled the issue of racism and the diversity, but do you think this latest movement will see some real change?
Well, let's back up to that comment really quick that I wrote in the book. I don't think that me or you or anyone watching this will ever be able to fathom the impact and pain and suffering that slavery and racism has caused in this world, simply for the fact that there are millions and millions and millions of undocumented stories of kidnapping, of rape, of abuse, of suffering and injustice and slavery. Josiah Henson, despite the pain and the horrific abuse he went through, he's one of the lucky ones who got to be free and write his story down and be well known and survive. We will never fathom the depth of despair that we've caused to our brothers and sisters in this world, specifically in the case of the tribes of Africa that we kidnapped and brought over to Brazil and America and all over. Mm-hmm. As for Canada, one of the big surprises for me was that First Nations chiefs owned black slaves. Mm-hmm. That was something that came up, you know, Brantford is named after Joseph Brant. He was a First Nations chief and he owned enslaved children. Just things you don't think about. They're like, wow, like people are just horrible to people. That's just like what we do for some reason. So as for Black Lives Matter and what's going on right now, what's interesting is that you can't root out slavery and you can't root out racism by protests or by legislation. It has to be a change of the heart, right? It's at the end of the day, the elimination of racism from my heart, from your heart, like any sort of prejudice, any sort of prejudging others, it's a spiritual act, right? It's very much a changing of our thoughts, our spirits, our souls, whatever you want to call it. It's a changing of our minds that physical force and legislation can't change. So to answer that question, do I think this is going to make a difference right now? We're already seeing that it is. There's no question that people's minds are changing. But yeah, even still, you know, I posted this article this week, and for the past week, I've had to just been like deleting comment after comment after comment, just like hardcore racist, vile things that, you know, I basically what my article said was like, hey, if we're going to be tearing down statues, let's consider maybe putting up a couple of monuments to Josiah Henson. And most people are, of course, they think that's a great idea, but there are some people who are heinously against that idea and in favor of like, let's put up more Confederate statues, right? Like the complete opposite of like how you or I would think on this issue. But the reality is we're not going to change their opinion by forcing it. It's going to happen through love, through understanding, through dialogue. And that is going to take a lot longer than I think maybe the militant tip of the spear would like. So we're going to see overcorrections in some area, but I think overall, we're actually going to still see an undercorrection because racism doesn't get rooted out that fast. Like, here's just a simple example. I was in Charleston, South Carolina earlier this year before lockdown, whole other world. And Michelle and I were walking down a street. You know, Charleston is where the first shot of the Civil War was fired on Fort Sumter, right? It's like a hotbed of the Confederacy. And we're walking down the street and this couple with these two kids were walking towards us. And the man had a Confederate tattoo flag on his leg. So instantly I kind of, you know, like I kind of perked up like, whoa, that's kind of, right? Like if in a Jewish context, it's like a Nazi flag, right? Like that's what that means to, especially in the South, right? Like Confederate flag. And as they walked past us, his little daughter, maybe 6 or 7 years old, she was goofing around. The best way to say it is she was aping around. She was like, ooh, ooh. She was literally just like, just goofing around, just being a kid, right? The dad's completely just no guile, no, just his natural response as we walked past. He smacked her upside the head and he said, hey, act like a white person. And Michelle and I, we like stumbled to our car like, what in the world just happened? That was like his natural response. It was absolutely heartbreaking. And as we got in the car, I wanted to like, in my head, I wanted to go back and just like hold that little girl and be like, listen, your daddy is doing the best he knows. And this is what he believes. And I don't know why that is, but he's wrong. You know, black people, they're not all bad. They're not all good. White people, they're not all bad. They're not all good. We're a big, huge global family just trying to figure out how to get along. But I'll tell you one thing. Goofing around, that doesn't make you black or white. Your dad is way out to lunch on this one. So something like that, what do you do? Do you take away that guy's kid? Do you throw him in prison? Do you remove his tattoo? Like, how do you get rid of the racism in that man? It's going to take love. It's going to take understanding. It's going to take time. So is change going to happen from this? I hope so. I hope it's the right change in the right amount. We're obviously praying that humanity fulfills its destiny to become one family, but we will see.
Yeah, we will see. Yeah. Today's Canada Day. So as we reflect on what it is to be Canadian and thinking about Josiah Henson's life, what importance do you put in his role in the development of our nation?
So I think the big moment for me in Henson's life is when he gets to the Niagara River and he's going to cross into Canada from the States. And this kind Scottish captain offers to pay to send them across on the ferry. And the man asks Josiah, are you going to be a good man? And Josiah replies, yes, I will use my freedom well. And history has shown that he gets to Canada and he doesn't just like settle into a comfortable Canadian suburban lifestyle, kicks up his feet, watches Netflix, orders in, and that's the end of Josiah's life. No. He goes back to his own state where he was enslaved and he rescues others again and again and again. And he agitates in the Southeast or in the Northeast for the elimination of slavery, and he fundraises for the cause and he builds churches and he builds a school and he does all this stuff. Even into his 80s, he's still fundraising to erect new churches and help people. And he almost goes to prison because he funds families when they send their sons and brothers off to fight in the Civil War. You know, he's risking a lot again and again and again. As Canadians, we have a lot of freedom. We live with some form of democracy, right? Westminster parliamentary democracy. We have a lot of economic freedom. We have a lot of freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom of association. We have a lot of freedoms in Canada. My worry is that we will get lax in those, that we'll just kick our feet up and be consumers as opposed to contributors. And so for me, Josiah Henson's life really is about the stewardship of freedom. And the question that's been rattling around in my head ever since I learned Henson's story is, am I using my freedom well? Am I stewarding my time, talent, and treasure on behalf of those with less than me? Because the reality is, we are one gigantic family. Everyone on earth is at most 70th cousins. I wouldn't treat my brother or my niece or my sister or my mom or my dad the way we see people in this world treating each other, right? And even in my worst moments, I treat my own family like garbage, let alone strangers. And our stewardship of freedom is figuring out how to love each other the way we want to be loved, practicing the golden rule. And that was something that just Josiah Henson just did really well. And I would love to see Canadians, with all our freedom, steward that well, to treat our own First Nations well, to treat our minority groups well, to treat other nations well. I would love Canada to be strong and free to serve others. So I think that's a good encouragement from Josiah's life that I want to bring into this new year in Canada.
Awesome. And I think that's a great lead into your documentary, which if people look in the description below, they'll see a link to the TV Ontario website where they can view it from the comfort of their own home. And I encourage them to go there now and take a look at your fantastic documentary. So I'm going to throw it to you to introduce it in just a second, but just to remind folks that check out the links below, follow us on our social media channels, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, and that's where you're going to see the postings for our content coming up this summer and into the fall. So we look forward to seeing you there. So without further ado, Jared, I'll throw it back to you.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I hope you enjoy this film. It's the life of Josiah Henson from birth until he reaches Canada. It first premiered on PBS for Black History Month last year. It's been seen by over 1 million people so far, over 1,000 screenings. And I'm really excited for you to be introduced to the life and the legacy and the lessons of Josiah Henson.
Awesome. Happy Canada Day, Jared.
Thank you. You too.